Hey guys, this is Craig Migliaccio with AEC Service Tech, and today what we're going over are six of the most commonly misdiagnosed parts on a furnace. So we're talking about parts that are blamed as being the problem for a no-heat service call, but I'm going to be going over just kind of an overview of each of these parts and the testing procedure. But in the description down below, I have multiple videos on each one of these components that I'm going to be describing. So I'm going to go ahead and get started. The first one is a flame rod. There's a lot of flame rods that are sold at supply houses, online. There's no need for that. So a flame rod would end up going in here. And the thing is, you're lighting the flame over here with a spark ignition or a hot surface ignition. The flame comes across here. And this is it's kind of like a flame proving rod. But what's actually happening is the control board is looking for a DC microamp signal from the ground, but what's happening here is you're sending anywhere from 80 to 180 volts into the flame, and the electricity is getting rectified in the flame. And basically what's happening is over at the control board, it's trying to prove the DC microamp signal. So there's a way to measure that signal when you have a multimeter in series with this flame rod. And the biggest thing about this is what I want to say is we clean this flame rod with unsoaped steel wool, but these do not go bad, really. The only time they go bad is when they're very, very tiny, such as on a smart valve. They have very small flame sensor or flame rod, and sometimes they get corroded and just bent, and they're just too small. You know, you want to make sure that the flame rod is enveloped in the flame, those types of things. But you can check out full videos on that in the description section below. Another problem is the gas valve, and you can use a tool like this, such as a manometer and a multimeter, in order to diagnose if your gas valve is bad. So if you have an intermittent flame, or maybe you're not having a flame, you need to make sure that you're getting your 24 volts at the gas valve on these standard single speed or two speed or even three speed gas valves. The modulating ones are different because it's basically a communicating control board here, communicating with the control board over here. But as for a standard gas valve, you can check the AC voltage here, and then what you're doing is you're measuring your incoming gas pressure with your manometer. So you're measuring your input, and you can also measure your output over here. So you want to make sure that you have the correct gas input here. You want to make sure that you have so basically there's a tap down here, but you want to make sure that you have the correct gas flow coming in, and that is consistent. And so that when this turns on and the gas is coming into the burners, that the supply is not falling dramatically. You want to make sure that you're still getting the correct gas flow coming out of here, and you can check that on the rating of the furnace. So that I have a video on that down in the description section below, so you can use each of these tools to diagnose that. Another component that is blamed as being bad quite often is the pressure switch. Now, these are in no particular order, from the one that gets blamed the most to the part that gets blamed the least, but I will say that the pressure switch gets blamed an awful lot. And one of the reasons for that is that this component is fairly cheap. So a technician may be willing to gamble and say, oh yeah, you know, I think the pressure switch is the problem. They buy a pressure switch for, say, $25 or something like that. They come back, but there's nothing worse than replacing a component and the furnace is still not operating correctly. So you want to make sure that you can diagnose this correctly the first time, and so you know what component is bad. So you can read a pressure switch with a water column manometer such as this. So you can actually tee into this tube right here in order to see what your water column reading is. And on a pressure switch, it'll tell you usually what the reading should be in order for these normally open contacts to close. So these contacts are supposed to close once the inducer motor is running, and if there's no water in here and the pressures are correct, basically. But what's happening is this is a proving switch to make sure that the inducer motor is running, the exhaust is working, and depending on the tube setup, if the intake is clogged, that's what it's doing. So this little pressure switch can get checked with a water column manometer and a multimeter, but it can also get checked with a tool such as this. This is a SDMN6, and it has an internal pump inside. And so you're actually able to isolate the pressure switch from the rest of the furnace and test it by itself. So you can see right away if the pressure switch is bad. You would just disconnect these with the power off and test it with that tool, and you'll be able to tell if this is functioning properly or not. So this pressure switch right here, should have the WaterCom readings in which it should close at, but if not, you can actually look up the model number right here and find that out online. So I have multiple videos on the pressure switch. So I have how the pressure switch works. I have replacing a faulty pressure switch. I have a bunch of different videos, such as the SDMN6 testing the pressure switch by itself. So you can check them out down in the description section below. A fourth component that gets blamed as being bad a lot is the control board. So the control board a lot of times is a mystery to technicians. You know, how does it work? How do you test it? But the reality is you test it by knowing the sequence of operation of the furnace in which you're working on. So whether that's a pilot ignition or whether this is a direct ignition with a hot surface igniter, you kind of have to know the sequence of operation and what's supposed to happen in order to diagnose this. So basically you have your signals coming in, which are your thermostat wire signals. So if you turn the fan on, you're gonna have the 24 volts coming out of R on the control board, and then the thermostat R and G are gonna touch. Then G is gonna come back to the control board and it's gonna have 24 volts on the control board. It's gonna tell the blower motor to turn on. So likewise, the same thing with the heat, R and W are gonna touch in the thermostat and W is gonna come back to this control board and you're gonna have 24 volts on the W. That's gonna start the sequence of operation for heat. So the first thing that turns on is the inducer motor. Then after the inducer motor is running, the pressure switch closes. Then after the pressure switch closes, the hot surface igniter turns cherry red. Then after that, the gas valve opens up the full gas flow across here. So then after that, you have a flame proving signal sent from the control board over to this flame rod. So the flame rod looks like this. It's enveloped in the flame and your control board is looking for a DC microamp signal because it's sending AC voltage through the flame rod into the flame and it's looking for a DC microamp signal coming back through the ground. After it sees that there is a flame through the flame rectification process, then you have a blower motor on delay. So it's waiting for the heat exchanger to heat up inside because you don't want cold air being blown on you. So then the blower motor turns on and now you have your home or your building getting heated. So you want to know your voltage path of your low voltage wiring. So if you have a 24 volt signal on the W, you want to know to be able to test for your 120 volts coming to the inducer motor, that should be coming off of the control board. So when it's time for the blower motor to turn on, you should have 120 volts up here on this black little relay going to your blower motor. So you want to know where to test at. So I have a video going over the furnace control board linked down in the description section below, as well as thermostat wiring linked down there as well. Another component that gets blamed as being bad is a ECM blower motor. And this one right here is a 2.3 version. So it's a 16-pin connector and it has high voltage all the time. So something like this can get tested very easily with a tool such as this. So this is a TechMate Pro. And also I have another video on how to test these without using a tool such as this. So using 24 volts in order to test these blower motors by themselves. So you're still gonna have the high voltage connected, but you're gonna take the low voltage 16-pin connector or the other 4-pin connector out and you're gonna test it with 24 volts. Here's another one. This is a ECM 3.0. These are Gentech blower motors. So these are ECM blower motors that are controlled by the control board, but you're still able to test these, even though it may not be very easy to test them with a multimeter by themselves. It is easier to basically leave the high voltage and test them with a tester, or also just knowing which pins you can test with just 24 volts in order to see the blower motor turn. So this is a hub, and this is the component that's usually bad on the blower motors. It's usually not the actual motor itself. That's a three-phase motor, but it's usually the hub that's bad. So I have multiple videos on this down in the description section below. Another component that gets blamed as being the problem is the heat exchanger. And the heat exchanger, if it has a crack, can be a dangerous thing for the homeowner. So you want to basically either stop the furnace from working or replace the furnace or replace the heat exchanger. So the issue with replacing a heat exchanger, it's a very laborious effort in order to replace that. You have to take all this off in order to get the new heat exchanger, even if it is under warranty by the manufacturer. It's just a long, laborious process. So the thing I want to mention to you is that whenever possible, confirm that there is a hole in the heat exchanger. So you want to be able to prove that to the homeowner, because unfortunately there's technicians out there that are just saying, oh, there's a crack in the heat exchanger and that's it. They're not proving it. They're not, and they're probably, sometimes they're not sure, you know, of that. But if there is a crack in the heat exchanger, that will allow carbon monoxide into the home, into the building. And that's dangerous for people to breathe. And that can potentially lead to somebody dying. So, you know, we have a lot of weight on our shoulders here as technicians. So if you ever come up to a furnace and say the flame rollout switch up here is tripped, that is a very good indication that there's probably a crack in the heat exchanger, but you want to start testing that out. So this may not happen either if it's just a small crack or it opens up as the heat exchanger warms up. This flame rollout sensor may not trip and you still may have a crack in a heat exchanger, but you want to confirm this. So there's a hole back here, usually, and it's for a high temperature limit switch. I know you can't see it, but it's about a hole about this big. So you can put a video scope in there. You can put a video scope down inside the burner tubes. You could put the scope. Sometimes you can get to it from the evaporator coil if you take the cover off. And sometimes you have to take the triangle piece that's in here. You have to take that out of the way, or you could drill a hole over here in order to get your video scope in there. On package units, you can usually see that by taking a plate off, and the heat exchangers are right there. So you want to, whenever at all possible, visually confirm that crack in the heat exchanger for the homeowner's sake. So they know, hey, you know, this technician really knows what they're talking about, proved it to me, done. You know, so another way is you can look up it in through, if you take the blower motor out, especially if it's an 80% efficient furnace, you can see the bottom. You know, there's different ways in which you can try to visually see it, but it is a little hard because it is back there. So as technicians, you know, there's a lot of weight on our shoulders, so you want to make sure that we're not guessing on what component is the problem. You want to confirm that, so that when you're ordering that component, when you run to the supply house and you're fixing that furnace, you know that once you replace that component, that it's solved and it's done. So I've put out a lot of videos on troubleshooting different components in a furnace, and I hope they're helping a lot. So you can check all them out in the description section below. If you want to help support this HVACR training channel, click here. If you want to subscribe, click here. And if you want to see another HVACR training video, click right here. Hope you enjoyed yourself, and we'll see you next time at AEC Service Tech Channel.